Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Bounce Back Thursdays. This is a weekly talk aimed at empowering you with the information you need in helping your business bounce back from the challenges of the COVID-19 pandemic. The topic of discussion is money recovery. Earlier, we covered several subtopics under this topic. If you missed it, the links to those videos are in the description. Also in the description is a Google form. If you are facing any difficulty with money recovery, then please enter your contact details in the form. At the end of the month, we're going to shortlist a few people and help them send legal notices to concerned parties. So make sure you enter your contact details in the form. Having said that, let's move on to the topic of this week, which is steps involved in insolvency and recovery process. Joining me, as always, is the manager for growth and strategy here at Vakil Search and the subject matter expert, Mr. Antim Amlan. Welcome, Antim.
Hi, Rana. It's great to speak with you again. Let's move ahead with the insolvency resolution process for the day.
Yeah, sure thing, Antim. So let's get started, like you said, and let's start with what are the steps involved in the insolvency and resolution process.
Yeah, thanks, Rana. So as we discussed the initiation and basically the procedure involved last time, for the day, we will discuss what happens once the insolvency petition by the NCLT is admitted. Okay. So okay. On the admission of application of initiation of CIRP, the next thing that happens is basically the appointment of the insolvency resolution professional. Okay. So now insolvency resolution professionals are specially skilled licensed professionals who are, skillful with administering the resolution process, managing the assets of the debtor, and helping the decision making for the entire process, right. And in the after that, a committee of creditors is constituted, as we also discussed last time, and then a particular resolution plan is framed and is approved further by the NCLT. Let's say if a resolution plan is not created or not approved, or not the committee of creditors fails to decide the resolution plan, then it goes on to the liquidation, right?
Right.
So there are two alternatives that can happen once the resolution plan is approved. It can go towards the complete resolution as per the approval of the NCLT, or it can also go into the liquidation. Now, to discuss few important things involved in the entire process. So once this particular order is admitted, order is given by the NCLT and the application is admitted, I meant, it goes on to kicking off a moratorium period. Now, what is moratorium? Moratorium is basically a 180 days time bound process that basically implements certain restrictions with respect to a particular debtor, a corporate debtor, okay. Right? Some of these things are, let's say, that bar or any kind of legal proceedings to be initiated against the corporate debtor, which means that any person cannot file any kind of legal proceeding against that particular debtor. Then no transfer of assets is allowed, and no enforcement of any security interest is allowed, and no recovery or any other kind of transactions from the company is allowed. And also the board of directors are immediately suspended from any kind of function. And the same role is basically taken over by the insolvency resolution professional, right? And some of these important things are basically management of the affairs of the company, then management or kind constitution of the committee of creditors. And the committee of creditors basically constitutes of all the financial creditors with the voting rights and voting share as per the claims, okay, as per the debt owned by the corporate debtor.
Okay.
So all of these functionalities and management are basically the role of a resolution professional. Now, before I just conclude, so the resolution plan involves certain important things such as evaluation matrix. Let's say if the committee of creditors feels that a particular, the company can be resolved if we bring in some new changes, or if the company is sold out and or acquired by another competitive business, then the resolution plan is approved based on an evaluation matrix that is formed by the creditors. Then liquidation, which is one of the ultimate end results that may happen, is basically also a part under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. And it has some steps involved, such as initiation of the liquidation, appointment of the liquidator, and then the complete dissolution of the company. And to put it more easily for our viewers, liquidation is basically when the assets of a particular company are broken down and then sold out to any of the prospective bidders or buyers.
Sounds like there are a lot of moving parts involved. So can you take us through some real life examples where these steps have been involved?
Yes, of course. Important insolvency proceedings that I remember was basically against the Bhushan Steel. So Bhushan Steel is a steel conglomerate which were acquired by the Tata Steel company. And Bhushan was declared insolvent by some of the lending banks and financial creditors. So after that, the insolvency resolution process started, and then the Tatas acquired it. So it was basically according to the resolution plan that the committee of creditors came up with. Now, a similar example can also be found in the Yes Bank situation and the Yes Bank crisis that we all have heard about and faced.
Yes,
personally a Yes Bank customer also. So
it was quite a newsmaker. So
we heard how RBI moved in. That was a bit different because RBI also has a major regulation and is a major regulator over the banks. But then the Yes Bank has now been acquired by the State Bank of India, basically. So the Board of Directors of State Bank of India basically came in along with the other financial creditors and took charge of the entire situation, and then it was resolved. So these are some situations where the resolution was achieved. But let's say in some case the resolution is not achieved, and the company, there is no other way out for the company to be resolved and stabilized in a way. Right. So in that case, the situation only prompts for one thing, that is the liquidation of the company and dissolution of the company. Then whatever money is gained after the liquidation is basically paid off to the creditors and settled off based on the percentage of the claims.
Thank you for sharing those examples. That helped me relate to the situation much better, because again, these were in the news and we all read about them. So, are there any more points to be covered under this topic?
Yes. So in the recent times, since 2016, the insolvency resolution process has impacted the merger and acquisition environment in our country. And that's why during the acquisition, the acquired company should conduct due diligence of the target company, in this case the SIC company, and also make sure that the takeover code, the SEBI laws, and especially the delisting procedure is kept in mind.
All right, Antim, this brings us to the conclusion of this week's talk. So looking forward to connecting next week to talk about NPAs and other recovery mechanisms for banks. So until then, thank you. Take care.
Thank you, Rana. Take care.